Friday speaker. She will, she's invited by our illustration tutor, and her name is Emily Rand, and she's a fabulous British illustrator and author. She's based in London. She studied at the Pembroke College of Arts and at the LCC.
Can you repeat again?
Camberwell College of Arts and LCC. And furthermore, she illustrated two picture books, A Dog Day and In the Darkness of the Night. And she's currently also working on her third picture book. And as any other kind of maker, surprisingly, she brought books. I've seen before people that work with books, and quite often they won't focus much on the presentation, but she brought fabulously physical things. And without further ado, Emily Rand.
Hello, hi. My name is Emily, and I am an illustrator and picture book maker. And I say picture book maker because I'm primarily an illustrator, but I also write the stories in my picture books as well. I'm also really interested in the sort of form and the book as a whole. So I think about the images and the story and also the physical form of the book at the same time. So I'm really interested in the way the image sits on the paper, the feel of the paper, the size and shape of the book. So today I thought I would tell you a little bit of the structure of my talk. So I'm going to tell you a bit about, show you some of my work and talk about it project by project. And then I will explain how I make my work, so the techniques and the process going from like the first idea to the final work. And then I know that when you're at college or university, it's a real mystery of how you go from student or making work to then getting it out and it becoming real and in the world and published. So I'm going to explain a bit about how I did that, my sort of journey to being a published author and illustrator. And then I'm going to tell you a bit about the illustrators who inspire me. So, Michael was the head of the board of my company. I don't know if most of you are studying illustration or studying other things in art and design, but hopefully this is going to be interesting. And then I can take some questions from you at the end. I'm also trying to sort of go through chronological order of the projects and in the So this is a book that I made. It's called In the Garden, and it was published in 2014 with a small publisher called Hatton Press. They're based in London, and they're mainly like a lithograph printing press, but they also started publishing sort of small artist books and some children's books by artists and illustrators. So my inspiration for this book was I was working in a gallery in the middle of a park, which is the Serpentine Gallery in London, and I was working in the bookshop there. And every day when I walked to work, I was walking through the park, and I was really interested in like, the sort of layers of the bushes and the trees in the park. And I was kind of thinking about how a book is, like, looking through a book is kind of like moving through a space. And I wanted to sort of explore, like, and turning a page is kind of like looking around the corner of something. So I wanted to explore the idea of like exploring an environment through the format of the book. And so each of the pages, there's no words, and there's lots of patterns, different patterns and textures of sort of plants and trees. Yeah, it's just been sort of two or three colours, and I was just sort of experimenting with the sort of different sizes and shapes of the pages. So that's one book. Also at the end you can feel free to come and have a look at the physical books that I've shown you. So this is the first, my first published children's book, which was published by Kate in 2014. And it's the story of a dog who really wants to go to the park. So my idea for this book came from kind of seeing, often my ideas start as like really tiny things that I'm noticing, or sort of a tiny little seed in my mind that sort of grows and grows. So I was noticing, I love dogs, and I was noticing that dogs have this kind of really sort of patient and demeanor of the, I kept seeing dogs basically waiting for their owners outside shops, and I was kind of feeling that maybe a child could empathize with the life of a dog, that they're kind of in some way constrained and living in the world of a boring adult and having to be accompanied everywhere when all they really want to do is just go and run with their friends. So the idea for this very simple story sort of came about. And I kind of just started making it. I started making it in black and white, and then I just didn't really. It just stayed in black and white. I kind of initially sort of thought that I would add colour, and then I guess my eyes sort of adjusted like do when you're watching a black and white film. Suddenly you kind of don't notice that it's black and white anymore. You just I'm also really interested in patterns and drawing the patterns and textures, and working with a very limited colour palette sort of helps me to just focus on the patterns and all the sort of really intricate line work that I really enjoy. So yeah, that's that one. Then this one was the second in a series of the same as this one. So this one was a bit of a success, so we decided to do a second one and had the idea for the same thing, like exploring a place or a space through the format of the book. And this one is about the city, and it's kind of inspired by when I was getting the train to work in the morning, and the trains in East London, or any time you go into the city, you kind of see like the backs of the buildings and the sides of the buildings and the bits that you're not really supposed to see, the sort of ugly bits. And I was kind of also inspired by the way that buildings sort of were close to each other and overlapping and layered. So yeah, it's the same sort of idea, that kind of see the whole of the city, and then as you turn the page, you kind of reveal different parts of the image. And it's supposed to be kind of, initially when I was making the book, I was making the drawings in black and white, and we didn't really think about the color. And then when we came to choose, it was printed on a risograph, so I do all the drawings in black and white, and then we decide which colors we're gonna print in, and I hadn't really thought about the colors, but they wanted, we couldn't really just do it in black and white. So then eventually we chose blue, black, and then it's got like a spot yellow and a spot red, which kind of makes it look like either sort of early morning or sort of early evening. Gives us this idea of sort of nighttime or dusk or dawn. So you've got the lights on. After making this, I kind of felt like there was a potential for a story there, in the sort of dark or the nighttime in the city and all the things that are going on either behind closed doors or things that you don't notice because you're in bed. So I was also thinking how the nighttime is kind of a mystery, some sort of mystery or excitement in the nighttime for children, and because obviously they're in bed and it's kind of an exciting time and they're not sure what's going on. And also the idea that they're hearing noises from their bed and they might not quite know what they are. So this book sort of tells the story of the nighttime from when the child is going to bed to when they wake up, and it's kind of told through the noises they will first hear from their beds, like maybe the dripping of the tap or things washing up in the kitchen, then out into the streets, the cars and the mopeds, and then further out to the city to sounds that they can't hear, like the people that are working in the city during the night time, like cleaners, nurses, like railway engineers. And then again with this one, I was using like quite a limited colour palette, so I was doing all of my drawings in black and then scanning them in and adding colour digitally. And that sort of allowed me to put a lot of detail and pattern into my illustrations. After working on this, I was just really sort of sick of drawing in black and white, drawing in black ink, and I just wanted to use collage and pens and stuff. So I had this idea about, it's about a lost property office, basically, and it's about this little girl that loses a teddy bear and her grandpa. So I guess maybe it looks quite different to my previous work. I don't know. I find it difficult to tell. But I've been using collage and a bit of drawing too, and can kind of lot more. It's quite a different way of working. But I think maybe the thing that the consistent thing is maybe this flat, sort of quite flat perspective that I work with. And it's something that I kind of can't or don't want to get away from, that maybe it's something that makes my work quite distinctive. I guess that's similar to the one with the dogs. When I was making this one, I also kind of the idea was coming from reading or looking. I also have a daughter, and I now read and look at children's books quite a lot from having I'm forced to have to read lots of children's books, and I love children's books, so that's quite a handy thing. But also I was sort of becoming aware that lots of children's books that are being published they have this kind of like message. There always has to be a message or a moral, and I kind of felt like it was adults making books about what they wanted to tell children, like what they thought was important. I'm going to tell you this, because this is important. And I kind of was just a bit like, that lots of books didn't really appeal to my daughter and the kind of things that she was interested in or things that really mattered to her. So I wanted to make a book about something really small, because I think you can still find really important messages or morals, even in things that seem really not significant or maybe sort of small or everyday. So although it's a story about a lost teddy bear, it's also about the relationship between a child and the grandfather. It's also about the city, and it's about things and empathy and things that matter to a child, sort of making them feel important by really valuing what's important to them. But saying that, probably my next book that I'm just thinking of the idea now is probably about some really huge issue. I'm really obsessed with consumption and overconsumption and plastic and pollution. I might try and make a book about that. So every time I work on a book, then next one I want to do something different. So yeah, it's also I was interested in the sort of body language between parents and children, and how when I'm with my daughter, especially, I feel like we're always rushing and kind of like, you know, dragging her around all the time. And then grandparents have this really special relationship, I think, with their grandchildren, and that they have that time, they have that sort of more understanding. So, something else. Okay. So why didn't I say that's sort of my main big project. I do also sort of do illustrations for other things, like I recently did London Children's Book Fair. I did the sort of illustrations and identity for that, and I've also done some activity books and things like that, but sort of my main thing that I really love to work on is children's books. So I'm very lucky that I get to do that sort of as my main job. So how did that happen? So I studied at I graduated from my BA in 2008, and then didn't really know what to do next. I felt a bit disillusioned with illustration and didn't really know how I could make that into a job. It's kind of a time before children's books it's kind of like before there was this big resurgence in children's books, when they suddenly became more popular and more valued as an art form, I guess. So when I was at college, it wasn't really encouraged. It was seen as something quite twee or sort of a bit cheesy to do children's books. Everyone was doing editorial illustration, which was very like bold and like strong and very masculine, I think. It was kind of looked down upon to be a children's book illustrator. But then I went to Paris for like a holiday, and I went to the bookshops there, and I discovered all these amazing children's books which were being published in France, and also Italian books of really nice too, and they were kind of, they didn't look like children's books that I'd seen in the UK. They were really experimental and interesting and inspiring and really beautiful, and they just looked like beautiful illustrations rather than looking like children's books. So I just had some other jobs. Like I worked in a cafe and worked in a bookshop, and I think working in the bookshop was good because I was just surrounded by books all the time, and it was an art bookshop, and I think that was quite helpful and probably a big reason why I decided to start making books. So while I was working there, I made this book. So I just had this idea and I started making it, and I submitted some of the illustrations to this illustration competition at the Bologna Children's Book Fair, which is every year this huge children's book fair in Bologna, which is in Italy, and they have an illustrators competition, and I just submitted my work, and it's where all these publishers go, and they all have a stand, and it's like everybody in the children's book publishing industry is there. And so I was really, really fortunate for my work to be selected. I think there was maybe 80 illustrators in it, or maybe not, maybe 50 or something. Anyway, so that was great. And my publisher saw my illustrations for this book there and asked me if they could publish it. So that was in 2012, and then a few years later, the book was published. So it takes quite a long time from the publishing sort of calendar is quite slow. Like it will probably be, now it takes me sort of like a year from the first initial, no, first initial idea to like presenting it to my editor for me to hand in the work, and then probably 6 months later, after I've handed in all my submitted all the files, then the book's published. So it's quite a slow process. Anyway, so before I went to Bologna, I had this idea for this book, and I also just made this myself. I self-published it. I had this idea, and I knew that I wanted to take something with me to Bologna to like show people, so I really wanted to get it finished. But actually made the illustrations for this book in 24 hours. I stayed up all night because I knew I wanted to send them off to the printer for them to be printed in time for me to like cut and bind them all before I got my flight to Bologna. So it's quite strange because I made all the drawings in 24 hours. And then a friend of mine, I gave her a book as a present and she put it up in her studio. And then somebody who was visiting her studio saw it and was like, wow, that's really nice. Can we publish it? So I would recommend that if you have an idea or you want to get a book published, you just have to sort of make it. Just make your book. Just make books, if that's what you want to make, or whatever it is that you want to make. You just have to make it and try and get it seen. So enter competitions or give things away, send things to publishers, and just get your work sort of seen and out there. But no, there's no point in getting your work out and seen if there's no work to show. So the first thing is to make the work and then get it out there. Make something that you're proud of, make something that you want to show people, and then people will want to see it. Missed out how I make my work. So my idea. So I said before that my work often starts from like a really tiny idea, like something I've noticed, and I do lots of. I'm not very good at keeping sketchbooks. I know that that's not a good thing to say because I'm really supposed to all keep sketchbooks, but I'm too sporadic, and I often just write down my ideas of whatever I have to hand. So when I was working in the cafe, that was the. That was the thing that you the order book. Or when I was working in the bookshop, we had these little forms where we wrote down all the book orders, and I would draw on those and write down random ideas on there. So they often start as just scribbles and drawings. And this is how that lost property book started. Drawing them on side and like a very, very basic idea on the other. And then what we have to do is that to write the story, and then I make a storyboard with these sort of rough thumbnail sketches. You see, Grandma was actually originally Grandpa, and then my publisher told me that it was too female, like every character is female, so that's changed one of them. Once my publisher has seen the storyboard and the story and a few like sample images, then they'll decide if they want to take it on. And then I work the thumbnails up into full page roughs, which are just pencil sketches of the finished illustration. And then I thought I'd show you some of my tools because I've been working with some of the illustration students this year and last year. And I thought it's really important to share the sorts of things that I like working with, because I guess you don't really know what tools to use unless you know that they exist, or you try them out, or you have a go with them. So these are the things that I use the most. So when I'm working in black and white, this is what I use. These are a Japanese pen. they're like a Pentel pen. It's sort of like a felt tip, but it's got like a slightly brushy tip. This is a Pentel brush pen, which is good. I often use a black ink and a paintbrush, but this is better, it's a bit neater. And then these are all my different nibs that I like to use, and they've all got a different thickness. And it just, and this is drawing ink. And they're just the dipping ink pens. They just give such a much nicer quality of line than a fine liner pen. Because I was originally using fine liner pen, and lots of this is done in fine liner pen. But I found that it's kind of more economical to work like this. And you don't have to buy so many pens. But also it gives like a much nicer quality to the line. It just has a slight like wobbly thing. So then what I do is I trace over using a light box. I trace over my roughs and I draw things up down in the pen. So this is called, these are some of the illustrations for this. So I will draw things separately and then scan them in, and then I can move them around on Photoshop, which is quite useful when you're working either for a client or for a publisher, because they might suddenly decide we want to change the shape of the book or the size of the book. Or they might say, oh, we need a bit more space for text. And then if you've done it as on just one illustration, you have to redo the whole thing. So this way I can move things around, make them smaller if I need to. So discover that's a better way to work. With this book, with my next book, it's not published yet, I used a lot of collage. So these are all of the things in the Lost Property Office. And I used collage and pens and lots of other bits and bobs, and scanned them in and then was able to move them out. So my Photoshop files have like hundreds of layers, which is something like that. Okay, so that's kind of how I make my work. And then I was going to talk to you about things that you might find useful. So the Bologna children's book there, if you're interested in children's book illustrations or being an illustrator or children's books, then definitely look at that. And once you have some illustrations for a children's book, you should submit them to the exhibition, because it's a great way to get your work noticed. There are probably lots of other children's book illustration competitions, so look out for those Google children's book illustration competition. LCAF is East London Comic and Arts Book Festival. That's every year, and lots of different independent and people that make their own books, but also publishers have stores there, and they have, so it's a good way to see what everybody's making and see all the things in real life, and also to meet publishers too. So if you're interested in, if you want to show something to publishers, you can take it there, and hopefully someone working at the store can tell you if they like it or who to contact. Because publishers get a lot of submissions, and some don't even accept submissions because they get so many. So often you need to find another way of approaching people, which is by competitions or getting your work out there in other ways. I think Nobrow, Blind Eye, I think they do take unsolicited submissions. So if you've made a children's book, they're also quite a young, kind of trendy children's book publisher. I met a girl the other day who they just published her final uni project that she did, a children's book that she did for her final uni project. So it does happen that people can get published straight out of college, but this one is really good. The Cambridge School of Art, it's an MA in children's book illustration, and they're really good. It's a really practical course, and they really explain how to make a children's book and how to get it published. They also have a store. children's book fair every year where they show all the illustrators' work, and lots of illustrators on that course get published straight off it. So if you know you want to make children's books and you can do an MA, then that's a really good one. And Pick Me Up is the illustration and sort of printed graphic arts fair. It's at Somerset House in London. I think every year, so that's good to go to. There's some children's book publishers. There's lots more, but they make quite interesting ones. And it's quite, if you sort of look at smaller publishing houses, like maybe not Walker, like big ones are like Walker or things like that. But if you go for smaller ones, they're often looking for sort of like up and coming talent. They can't pay very much. Their distribution is quite small. So they're looking for people that they don't pay loads of money, like Kate. I don't get paid very much. It's a good way. You've got to start from now. So now I thought I'd tell you a bit about the illustrators that I really love. There's absolutely loads. There's obviously loads of illustrators that really inspire me, but I thought I'd show you just a few. So Ezra Jack Keats was an American illustrator and author, and he is famous for doing these books about this little boy called Peter. He lives in New York. And I love his use of colour and collage and texture, and also the way that he makes his perspective, I think, is kind of similar to the way that I use perspective, that he likes doing this sort of long, sort of linear perspective, like it's this sort of constant side perspective. I use a similar thing for this book, so it's kind of like one long, continuous line of perspective. And they're quite almost all set in the urban environment, which is kind of where a lot of my books are set. I'm sort of inspired by what's around me, and I live in London, so my books are kind of pretty much always set in London. Yes, that's Ezra Jack Keats. All his books were published in like the 50s and 60s, and he was a Jewish man, but he was quite famous for being one of the first author illustrators that illustrated children of colour, which was really groundbreaking and surprising. So it was interesting. Beatrice Alamanga, she's a French author and illustrator, and it was her book that I first saw in Paris when I went there, and I was like, wow, I didn't know children's books could look like this. And she makes books that are kind of a bit different in their scale and size. The first book that I saw of hers was called A Lion in Paris. A Lion in Paris. And this is her newest one that I bought, which is about it's called A Magical Do Nothing Day. And I really like the way she does everything by hand. I don't think anything is digital. But all of her books really feel like she's kind of lived in them. Like there's so many things to notice, and little tiny details, which I really love, and I know I enjoyed those sorts of books when I was a child, like noticing all the kind of like secret details. So I really like that. And this is a designer and illustrator called Bruno Minari, who was Italian, and he was sort of made most of his work in like the mid 20th century. And his work, it feels really contemporary, although it's so old, I suppose. And I saw this book, and this kind of made me think about playing with the format of the book, and that you could use cut views and the shape and size of pages in a really interesting way. So this is a book that he made called Libro Illegibile. So it's like a book with no pictures or words. It's just using different coloured papers and shapes and sizes of pages to to make different compositions. So he was a big influence for me. And this is Tommy Andoa. He's a French illustrator and author. Actually, no, he's not French, sorry. He is from Strasbourg. I went to a talk by him recently, and I think it's great that you have these Industry Friday talks and you can listen to people talking about their work, but make sure that you also, there's lots of talks and things happening outside of the college, and then you should have a look at those. If there's people you find inspiring, find out if they're doing talks or lectures. I know maybe there's not so much going on in Luton, but you're not far away from London, and just off the train, is the House of Illustration, and they have lots of talks on in the evenings or daytime and stuff. So have a look or follow them on Instagram and Twitter and find out, you know, if it's like courses or talks and stuff on Instagram. Yeah. So I think that's it. Does anyone have any questions?
How will the new processes that you're using, the latest book,
yes,
change the print methods? And how do you use social media as well?
Okay. So the big, what's it called, the big books, but like proper, these are all printed with lithography. So they're big print runs. The publisher manages the print process for me. But what I am doing with this book is we're using, instead of the CMYK printing method, we're using a spot panto as well as the C and Y. So cyan, so this, when you print with, I don't really know if you know this, but when books are printed, like big, general, if there's lots of copies, you print with lithography, and it's a five-colour printing process. So CMYK, so that's cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. And that's how pretty much all books are printed, unless you use a spot Pantone colour process. And we're going to do that with this one, I think. So these are the proofs, these are colour proofs. Come back from the printer in China. So that's a CMYK proof, and this is with two of the colours substituted for two spot Pantone colours. So it's like a full colour printing process. So even though I've used like a limited palette in this one, it's still printed in full colour. But yeah, does that answer your question?
Yeah.
And the second one is social media. I'm not very good at using social media, but I do try. I don't have a Twitter, but I do have an Instagram, and I post there sporadically. But lots of illustrators do use social media in like a very professional way. I have lots of followers. I'm sort of not very good at that. I kind of have this an issue with doing things in like a very deliberate and way. And then hashtagging, it all feels a bit uncomfortable to me, personally. My work kind of, and people, it's like another job. Like, if you're going to do it properly, you have to think about posts every day, you have to make them look good, you have to like light it properly. And I just don't have the time to put into it. I know lots of people do it and it pays off, but yeah, it's not really my thing. Any other questions?
I saw that your first book was writer printed.
Yeah, these ones are writer printed.
Did you have that in your? We have a writer printer here.
Yeah.
And did you have that like in your thought when you were first doing it, or was it like, oh, I'm pregnant now, oh, that's open.
No, it was in my head. It was, yes, I knew I was going to print it, by so. Basically, I was talking to illustration students about it the other day. Often, when you're going, I knew I wanted to make a book, and I knew I had the idea, but I had to think, almost skip making the illustrations to the end, to think about how I was going to print it, and how I could afford to print it. Because Rizo is quite an affordable printing method, especially if you're doing short runs of books. So the first run was probably about 50 copies or less, and it was quite cheap for me to do it this way. It was the only way I could afford to print a book in colour. So when I made the artwork in a specific way that made it possible to print on the website, so I do, it works, it lends itself quite well to the way that I work, in that I like to draw in black and white, I like to draw in black and then scan that in and either change the colour digitally or put Rizo, you just submit your, you just send them the files in black and white. So yeah, and I did know that I was going to print it by then, which I think you kind of need to before you make the artwork.
Any other questions?
Which work are you most proud of?
I don't know, it's really hard. I think I have this thing where I'm really into the thing that I'm working on at that moment. So I guess it's quite hard to have sort of perspective, like, I don't know, I still really like these books, and actually this one, although it's probably the one that took me the least amount of time because I actually made it in 24 hours, like just one day, I still really like it. And so that's the oldest thing I made, and then I suppose the newest thing I've made is always feels like most like what I'm doing now, so then I just said like that. But then as soon as I finish the book, I hate it. Like, I can't look at it. I don't want to look at it ever again. And even after I finished this work, as soon as this one was published, I had to do some readings of it to some bookshops and stuff. So to sort of practice, I was reading it to my daughter, and I just didn't want to look at it. Whenever I look at it, I just see things that I want to change or that I don't like anymore. So it's quite hard. But then after I've had a bit of distance from it, so maybe in a few years I'll feel differently. But at the moment, probably I quite like this one. But as soon as it's published, I'll hate it and I won't want to look at it. Also, because you spend so much time with it, you're just looking at it every day, and you're just like, oh, I can't look at it anymore, I'm so sick of it. And then once it's published, you can't change it anymore. Then it will be my next book. I kind of always think, oh, my next one's going to be the one that's really good. And then after I finished it, I don't like it. But yeah, that's the way it is. Anybody else?
Do you use most of your colour in Photoshop? And that colours the way you work. There's a lot of files.
So it depends on the way I'm going to print it, and it depends on the project. So this one I didn't add any colour to, so it's just black and white. These ones I did a black and white, and then the colour was added from the Rizo printing. So the drawings were all in black and white. And then this one, yeah, I added the colour digitally. Yeah, all the drawings were in black and white, and then on Photoshop I sort of coloured them in. And then this one was quite different because I scanned in things in colour. So I was using coloured inks and pens and coloured paper and stuff to make them as well. But I was also adding colour digitally. So for example, the skin tone, some of the other bits and bobs, just to add like depth and stuff. You might do that. But it depends on the project. Yeah.
How does it work with the small publishers? So, for example, you read that the In the Garden one is all cut out and you made it in the Rizo. Do they then produce it for you? Do you get commission on how much is sold, or is there a set fee that you get? Or?
It depends. So this one was, I'm self-published it, and then when they decided to publish it, they did a new print run. We made it look more professional. They got it laminated and cut, so they're made with a die cut rather than the other ones I was doing with scissors. They were doing much bigger runs. But it was one of the first books that they published, and they didn't really have enough money to give me. How it normally works with big publishers or big publishers is they give you an advance payment, which is like a lump sum, and then you get a percentage of the royalties, and then you sort of pay off your advance, and then once you've paid off your advance, you start getting royalties as well. But they didn't have enough money to give me like any money up front, so I get 50% of the profits from this book, but I didn't get enough funds. So in the long run, I don't know, it depends how many they make, but maybe very, very small, just starting publishers might work like that, and that they sort of give you quite a generous share of the proceeds, but they can't give you a sort of lump sum. The lump sum is quite important because it allows you to take that time to work on the book. So you might get a proportion at the start when you sign the contract, when they've decided to take on the book. They might give you a proportion of that advance, and that allows you to live while you're